Hello, students of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker, and welcome to this example video, which is going to present a solution for a problem with non-circular motion, where we can actually solve for multiple unknowns using multiple axis systems in the process I described in the previous video. Okay, so what we have going in this problem is that we have a non-circular curve. Now, I realize that the drawing here doesn't show it explicitly non-circular. I've got a little bit more accurate drawing in a video I'll show here, in an interactive I'll show here in a second. But the equation for r, r is equal to 1.5 times the function 2 minus cosine of theta. Okay, so that tells me how r changes as a function of this theta. Notice theta is measured over here from horizontal, basically from the positive x-axis going out to the right. We have information that the angular velocity at this instant, theta dot, is 5 radians per second. And we know that this collar right here has a mass, a weight of 0.75 pounds. Okay, that's the combined weight of both collars. There's basically a pin in the middle here because those need to change angle as one part of the collar tracks arm OA and the other part of the collar slides around this curved radius. So the instant that we're going to take a look at is at theta equals 120 degrees, and we want to solve for a normal force. That normal force is going to come from the curved rod, okay, pushing this collar into basically a curved path, and as well as a pushing force. So this is perpendicular to arm OA. And one other piece of information that's important is this note right down here. This is the top view of this system. Okay, so the top view means that the weight force be going right down through the middle of B, but perpendicular to all the motion, so we can ignore it for these computations. The problem additionally does not report any friction. Okay, so of those four forces that I listed out in the previous video, there's only going to be two here. There's going to be basically both the normal forces. To be honest, those two normal forces are the forces you can never get rid of. They will exist on any given problem. Okay, so to get us started on this problem, we're going to talk first about axis systems. And I created an interactive that we could look at those axis systems. All right, so here is a GeoGebra interactive. I'll put the link to this both on your content page as well as in the description on the YouTube video. And so here's where this collar is sitting. Here's also a more accurate description of this r is equal to 1.5 2 minus cosine of theta. You can see it's almost circular, but it's a little bit flat over here on this side. And then also notice that the origin is not in the middle of this path. Okay, that's what makes it a non-circular path, is that this origin point here, which is where your r and your theta are based around, are not in the middle of a circle. Okay, if they were in the middle of a circle, essentially your tangent normal and polar r theta collapse onto each other, and it's a much simpler problem. So given the information for this motion, and we're assuming for all of this that we have the negative right-hand rule theta dot. I didn't put that vector on this drawing here, but that will define the direction of our tangent axes. So I'd like you at least to start, maybe draw a small sketch off to the side, maybe just think through the different terms, but feel free to pause the video. I'd like you to draw the tangent, the normal, the r, and the theta axes for this collar at this current location. Okay, go ahead and pause the video and see if you can draw that. The tangent, the normal, the r, and the theta for the collar at this location, theta equals 120 degrees. Thanks for your effort on that. Right or wrong that you just worked through, you'll remember this topic better because you put in that effort. So I appreciate it. Okay, I'm going to click this box and it's going to show me those axis systems. So here are the tangent, normal, r, and theta. Tangent is going to be pushing in the direction, basically if this arm is rotating in a counterclockwise direction, it's going to have our velocity in this tangent axis direction. Normal is perpendicular to that, pointing toward the center of local curvature. R is pushing away from the origin, okay? Always pushing away from the origin is our R axis. And then our theta axis is in the direction of an increasing theta angle. So an increasing theta angle as theta gets bigger, it means it's coming over here to the left. I can change that with this angle if I want to and basically show how this TN and R theta axes change with motion. Now over here, as they get to Almost straight over, and there is a discontinuity here. I forget exactly why, but essentially right over here at this point, the Tn and the r theta collapse onto one another. And even here at 170 degrees, they're getting really close to each other, being collinear. But as I move this back around over here, say we only had theta is equal to 60, we get more and more separation. But r is still going through the point. Theta is always in the direction of increasing theta angle, n toward the center of curvature, and t in the direction of the instantaneous velocity, right, tangent to the curve. So hopefully that diagram helped you kind of think about the axis systems, think about where to get started on this problem. All right, let's lay the groundwork here for our free body diagram. And I'm going to draw that free body diagram over here. We'll just draw it as a particle for right now. Now, in order to transfer these angles, and you could do this either with a straight edge, or I'm going to do it here digitally, I'm going to draw in my tangent axes. I'm going to draw in my R axes over the top of that diagram. Then what I'm going to do, I'm going to grab a hold of them and bring them over to my point. So I get kind of an accurate representation of my R and of my T. Okay, so if I know that the R, and these are not perpendicular, this is non-circular motion. So R is perpendicular to theta. Theta is in the direction of increasing angle theta. So here would be my theta axes. Let me go ahead and move my T label, put it over here. And then my normal axes is perpendicular to T, coming down toward the center of curvature, so that would be my n. So my r, theta, t, and n, all the positive assumed directions. Now I could add, if I wanted to, the x and the y axes on here. I'm actually going to leave them off for now because I don't have any forces in the x and y, and so it'll just add further clutter to this diagram. All right, so I said I had two forces existing on the system. I had one of these forces, which is from the path. Okay, so this is going to be, I'm calling this force N. And then I also had the pushing force, which is along the theta axis. Okay, so I'm going to call that P. So there's my P, pushing force from the arm, and then also my normal force from the curved path. No weight, because this is the top view, and no friction, because we're assuming that this is a smooth rod. Basically, the curved rod is smooth, creating no friction. All right, so to keep progressing forward, we need to resolve some information first about the angles. Okay, and again, because I don't have any XY angles, I don't technically need to bring in my angle theta to this drawing, but I do need to bring in my angle psi, and psi is defined between the positive T to the positive or negative R, so that would put it here. Okay, there's my angle psi. And additionally, I need to bring some information about my values of theta and theta dot and R dot and R double dot so that I can compute my acceleration terms. Okay, so let's work through those. We know that R is equal to 1.5 times 2 minus the cosine of theta. Now, if I just go ahead and put in my 120 degrees, I can find out that at this instant that R is equal to 3.75 feet. Okay, that's the instantaneous value of R. Then if I take a time derivative of this R, I end up with R dot is equal to, the 1.5 can come along for the ride. When you take any derivative of a constant value, that 2 that's on the inside, that's going to go to 0. And so this is going to be minus, and the derivative of cosine is a minus sine of theta. Now here comes the implicit differentiation times theta dot, right? The time rate of change of theta on the inside is theta dot. One more parenthesis here to close that out. And so again here, I could go ahead and plug in, actually I won't do it yet because I don't have all my terms showing, but I'll be able to plug in my values for theta and theta dot to solve for my R dot, instantaneous value. And then here R double dot, need to apply this time the product rule, taking a time derivative of both sine of theta and also the theta dot term. Once again, I find it easiest if I have a multiplying constant on the outside of all of this, just to put it on the outside right there. And so what we have, I'll take the first term, noting that I had the negative of a negative sign makes that a positive. So let's go first times derivative of a second. So sine of theta, the derivative of the second term is going to be theta double dot. Add to that from the product term, product rule, the derivative of the first, cosine of theta. I do need that theta dot because I have to implicitly derive cosine of theta. And then here comes my theta dot, which comes from the second term. Okay, so I actually end up with two theta dot terms, or a theta dot squared. Now I'll come back and fill in those values right after I solve for all my theta terms. Okay, so theta. Now one thing that's interesting about theta, you can go ahead and leave this as 120 degrees as long as your calculator remains in degree mode, not radian mode, because all the thetas that show up in these equations are actually sines of thetas or cosines of thetas, right? It's a trig function operation of theta. Anywhere that you actually multiply theta, say times a distance, then you need to use the radian. Okay, so as far as if it's going to be inside a right triangle trig operator, sine, cosine, tangent, just make sure that your angle matches up with your calculator settings. Anytime you multiply angle theta, it has to be in radians. Okay, so here I'm going to leave this in degrees. My theta dot was given to me at a value of, back up here, 5 radians per second. Now this is the magnitude. You do need to pick up the sine on this from its direction. Okay, so if you wrap your fingertips around, put your fingernails in the direction of that arrow tip, your thumb should come out of the screen. And this is a positive note here from the right-hand rule. Okay. If it's negative, you need to list that as a negative value, and actually will go into your equations as a negative value. Last up here, we have the theta double dot, the time rate of change of theta, and the key word here is it was a constant theta dot, so therefore theta double dot is zero. Okay, so given those two values, I can go ahead and insert the known values of all my theta terms. I can find out that, let's see, I'll put it down below here, r dot numerically at this instant is 6.495. Once again, putting in theta dot as positive 5, putting in that sine of 120 degrees with my calculator in degree mode. This is a velocity, feet per second. And then r double dot, the radial acceleration, I find is, I take it back. R double dot is not the radial acceleration alone. It is the time rate of change of the magnitude of r dot. Radial acceleration also has another term, which we'll see here shortly. So my r double dot ends up being a negative 18.75 feet per second squared, right? Because it is an acceleration. And if you're wondering where the negative value comes from, it actually comes from this cosine of theta right here. The cosine of 120 degrees turns out to be negative 1/2. Okay, so the second term there in that equation ends up being bigger than the first one. And the biggest reason for that is that the first term is zero, because our theta double dot is equal to zero. Okay, so that's just the numeric value of our double dot at this instant. Okay, so as we went through all of our different steps, we created an axis system. We drew our free body diagram terms. Let's go ahead now and draw in our AR and A theta acceleration terms. Okay, make this a kinetic diagram. So here would be A theta. I'm assuming a positive A theta. And here would be my AR. So adding those terms makes this a combined free body diagram and also kinetic diagram, noting I used a different color, so I didn't need to use a different line type for my kinetic terms versus my force terms. All right, so then the next step is to resolve our acceleration as it relates to AR and A theta. We know that AR as an equation is equal to R double dot minus R times theta dot squared. So putting the values in here, we end up with negative 18.75, and then minus 3.75 times 5 squared. Noting if I'd ended up with a negative value of theta, that would go in as a negative 5, and I'd square it. And so in that case, it wouldn't change the sign. But just noting I bring in the signs into these equations. And so here I find that AR was equal to negative 112.5 feet per second squared. And then A theta from my equation sheet, I know A theta is equal to R times theta double dot plus 2 R dot theta dot. So 2, let me just cross something out here. We know that theta double dot was equal to 0 since that arm has no angular acceleration, because theta double dot fundamentally is the same thing as alpha, right? Angular acceleration. So 2 times my r dot value is a positive 6.495. And then my theta dot, once again, this one is positive 5. It'd come in as a negative. It was in the opposite direction. So I get a positive value here overall of 64.95 feet per second squared. So that tells me that my A theta indeed is going in this positive theta direction, but my AR is not. Okay, so this is assumed positive AR. I just got a negative value right here, so I've just assumed the AR was going in the wrong direction in my diagram, which is totally fine. But as I write the value in my equation moving ahead, I'll go ahead and put in this negative value because this is the known value. And if you know something, you want to put it in as the known value as opposed to an unknown as you move through your problems. All right, so before we get into splitting our forces into components, we need to find our value of psi. Okay, and so we know that psi as an equation is the inverse tangent of r over dr d theta. Okay, so we already found r, right? We know the instantaneous value of r. Now, is dr d theta, so is this equation here, the same thing as r dot? Reflect on that for a second. Is dr d theta the same thing as r dot? It is not, right? R dot is dr dt. And dr d theta is dr d theta. Okay, so very similar equations. And so we find down here that dr d theta is going to look exactly the same as our derivative, except for one thing. It won't have a theta dot. Okay, so it's going to be 1.5 times the sine of theta, but I don't have to do that implicit differentiation theta dot because I'm taking a derivative with respect to theta, which is in this equation. Okay, so then if I put in my known value of 120 degrees, I find that dr d theta numerically is equal to 1.3. So then I put those values here into my equation and I find that the inverse tangent of 3.75 divided by 1.3 gives me an angle of 70.89. Okay, so here's one part of your check that it's worthwhile to think, well, does this angle make sense? Okay, 70.89. I scroll back up and I see that I have, yeah, it looks like about 70.89 there between T and R. So let's go ahead and roll with that. And so now as we think about the final step, which is to break these forces into components and solve for unknowns, I need to take a look and figure out, well, which components do I need? Okay. So luckily on this problem, my force P is 100% in the theta direction. So I don't need to split it into components because it already is there, right? It has a component of just fully in the theta direction. But the problem is, or the challenge with this one, is dealing with n. Okay, so I'm gonna move my label here just a second, move it out here a little further to show that I can break n into two different components, one of those being nr, Okay, that's going to be negative. And this one here would be n theta. Now, I also need to bring in this angle psi in order to resolve n into r and theta components. Okay, and I can do that essentially by recognizing that I have a 90 degree angle between r to theta. Okay, I also have a 90 degree angle between t and n. So if I draw an additional angle here, let's call this alpha, I could basically write that psi plus alpha is equal to 90 degrees. So that would be if I used alpha as associated with theta and r. But what if I use alpha as associated with t and n? If alpha plus psi has to equal 90 degrees, it turns out that this also is psi. Okay, that angle between theta and n. So that mirrors what we talked about earlier. Once again, perpendicular from r to theta, perpendicular from t to n. And so you could really think here, if you rotated your r axes by psi, it's going to line up along your t, just like if you rotated your theta axes by psi, it's going to line up along n. Okay, so they're sharing this complementary angle alpha. Another way you can think about it is that whole idea of one item being perpendicular to another, right? So if r is psi from t, then theta also has to be psi from n because both those vectors are perpendicular to each other. Okay, so just kind of working through those angles, moving them around. And so we see here that the theta component is going to be related to the cosine of psi, and the sine component is going to be related to the radial component, n sub r. Once again, the cosine of psi times n will be n theta. Let me just write this out here. So we'll move this going forward. So the n theta is equal to n cosine of psi, and then n r is equal to negative, because it's in the negative r direction, n sine of psi. Okay, there's my two components, nr and n theta. So when I sum my forces in the n, excuse me, when I sum my forces in the theta and r, I'll include those terms. So let's go ahead and set that up. So finally, we're going to use sum of forces equals mass times acceleration to solve for the forces. Okay, so I'm going to start with my r. Sum of my forces in the r direction is equal to mass times acceleration in the r. So this is bringing together a whole bunch of pieces. Okay, so the only force in the r direction, if you take a look at your free body diagram, is going to be that nr. There are no other forces in the system in the r direction. So all we have for that one is negative n sine of this angle psi, 70.89 degrees. That is equal to the mass. Now, 0.75 is not a mass. It's a weight. That was the weight of the collar and pound force. Every pound you see in dynamics is pound force. So we divide that by gravitational acceleration, 32.2. This is feet per second squared. This is in pound force, converts it into a mass. And then we bring down the value of our acceleration in the r direction, which was a negative 112.5. Okay, so collecting all of these pieces from all over this problem, and we find that our value of the normal force is equal to 2.77 pounds. I end up with a positive value. Now, if you'd left off this negative sign right here, if you hadn't kind of already assumed that that normal force is going to be in the negative r, or had a negative r component, you would have got a negative value here, and it just would have validated that you drew your n in the wrong direction. But you would, if you, so let me revisit that here for a second. If you had drawn this one in the negative n, which is essentially saying that you drew your overall n going up this way, that you would also end up with a theta that was a negative value. Okay, so you can't just flip a component, either r or theta of n. You need to flip the whole n, which then flips both components. Okay, but we didn't take that path. We went ahead and assumed that n was coming in a positive normal, which in this problem is true. So coming back down to our final equation, summing forces in the theta equals mass times a theta. Similar process. Now we have two different forces here in the theta. One of those is going to be our force P. And then we're going to add to that the known value of n, 2.77. This is going to be the cosine of psi, 70.89. Those are the two forces in the theta direction. This is equal to my mass again, 0.75 divided by 32.2 to turn that into slugs. And then bringing down my a theta, 64.95. And here we could solve that pushing force is equal to, actually quite a small pushing force, 0.605 pounds. So there are the values of that pushing force from the arm, as well as the normal force from that curve. Okay, so here again, just for review, we started the problem by drawing an accurate diagram. We got our head around the motion. We figured out the sine on theta dot, kind of all the different pieces. We looked at an interactive to fully understand the axes. So we got our heads really around the motion. We then created a free body diagram and kinetic diagram, which reflected that information about the axis system and the overall motion. We then solved for instantaneous values of r, r dot, r double dot, theta dot, theta double dot, all of those instantaneous terms, plug those into our ar and a theta equations to solve for these instantaneous radial and transverse acceleration components. We then solve for our angle psi to figure out that angle between the tangent and radial axes. And then we substituted all these values in to our Newtonian F equals ma equations to solve for n and solve for p. So I know it's a good number of steps, but if you just break this down into a process, work on them one at a time, you should be able to work through all of these. Thanks for your attention today.